The federal structure in India, as you know, we are essentially a unitary form of governance we have in India, although there are some distinct federal features also. Trilochan Shastri, the author of this article, he says that historically, he recalls how India became a union of states. You all know that there used to be hundreds of princely states like Hyderabad, Travancore, Jodhpur, Bhopal, Junagadh, etc. And sometimes a war had to be waged before they became part of India, like the Nizam of Hyderabad who was subjugated, and Kashmir was forced to enter into an instrument of accession to India. Now, in India, the dispensation of finance between, the arrangement for the distribution of finances between the financial powers between the state and the center is the direct taxes such as income tax, central excise and customs, etc. They are with the central government, and other states may have to do with things like excise duty on liquor, etc., and property tax for the local bodies, and land revenue, etc. Also roads and vehicles taxes, things like that. Now, states in India are not allowed to collect, levy or collect direct taxes, which is the case in America. So direct taxes constitute nearly six, which they constitute a divisible pool, and approximately they about 41% of it, that total direct taxes are, according to the recommendation of the Finance Commission, distributed to the state governments. Now, the center also collects a number of cesses amounting to nearly 3.5 lakh crores per year, which are cesses. They are not taxes under the constitution, so they are not shared with the state government. And then the three levels of governance in India, the center, the states, and the local bodies, all as you come down, the powers decrease. And particularly at the panchayat or the urban local body level, the powers are very minimal and the revenues are very poor. In fact, it's an inverted pyramid, whereas it should have been just the other way around. Even the 73rd and 74th amendments do not appear to have helped very much. And at the All India level, states get about 26% of their annual requirement from this government of India, and some of the poorer states get about 50%. So the center has enormous economic power, and it is a very disproportionate kind of arrangement. Then regional disparity is also a major concern. Maharashtra, Delhi, Karnataka contribute nearly, together with Tamil Nadu and Gujarat, contribute about 72% to the government of India's revenues, kitty. And there is also a very distinct north-south divide in India. Nearly 51%, the southern states on average get about 51% for every 100 rupees of tax they contribute to the center. Whereas some states like Bihar get 200 rupees for every 100 they contribute. That means their contribution is actually negative, which is because of their backwardness. And the southern states, it's well known, have done a good job in controlling population. Whereas population control is relatively unsuccessful in the north, and population growth is still quite alarming in some of the northern states. So, but peculiarly, political power-wise, Bihar, UP, Madhya Pradesh, they account for the majority of the number of seats in parliament. Therefore, they have most of the power. So, unfortunately, political power and economic power don't seem to go together. And also, most of the people seeking employment and education migrate from the north to the south. Now, the complaint of the northern people is that, you know, Hindi is not respected by the southern people, that imposition of Hindi as a national language has been resented by them. And they, in fact, some unscrupulous politicians have in recent times started saying that why should we give so much money to the states which don't give us, proportionate encouragement in terms of politics, because the ruling party is not very, is not as popular in the southern states as it is in the west and in the north. So, finally, what the author says, Shastri says, is that separation of politics from economics and the task of distribution of taxes cannot be undertaken very easily. So Ultimately, the solution to this disparity is giving the states greater economic power and giving the panchayats and ULBs also a greater power authority. But for the not so well to do states like say Bihar, UP, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, etc., we cannot have a sudden transformation. So he argues in favor of a gradual transition to a regime of greater authority with states. And the Finance Commission former chairman, he has argued, one minute, I'll just get his name. Yeah, okay. You see, there are two phenomena the Finance Commission has Vijay Kelkar, the former chairman of the Finance Commission, he has pointed out two phenomena which are peculiar to our country. One is the vertical imbalance, that is fiscal asymmetry between the powers of taxation vested between the central and the state governments and the state governments and the local bodies. Then, particularly post GST, the states and these local bodies have even much less power than they used to, because GST is entirely taken away by the state and redistributed to the states in part. So this imbalance is having a very deleterious effect on India's urbanization, the quality of public goods, and aggravating the negative externalities for environment and climate change, naturally, because these are the priorities which would occupy a high place if the bodies at the lower level had enough authorities. And then he also points about horizontal imbalance, that is the differential capacity to tax among states as against expenditure required for public goods. And you see, they have a lot of responsibility, but they don't have enough funds. So this is a horizontal imbalance. So a vast regional imbalance is also in terms of per capita incomes, stage of demographic transition, physical infrastructure levels, social capital endowment, etc., mineral sources, geographical features. India is a very, very diverse country. So these are also issues which cannot be tackled until we have greater empowerment at the state level on the one hand, and on the other hand, a huge amount of funds available with an organization such as Niti Aayog to correct the imbalances that will arise if more and more powers are given to the states. So, in fact, there is a word for the direction in which we should go, which is called cooperative federalism. So this is my take on the two subjects today. I'll be happy to take any doubts or difficulties that you may like to ask.